Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Not Quite States of America, Dispatches from the Territories and Other Far-Flung Outposts of the USA, by Doug Mack, read by Jonathan Yen. Introduction. I've always believed the disorienting sense of arrival in a new place to be one of the great joys of travel. This, however, was a whole new level of confusion. On a clear January evening, I had boarded an airplane in Miami and flown across the sea. As we descended from the clouds, well after dark, I gazed down at the capital city, a tight cluster of low buildings and palmy treetops surrounding a broad harbor full of sailboats, their mast lights a swaying constellation against the darkened waters. The urban grid, traced by streetlights, was compact and orderly at the waterfront before tangling into a jumble of narrow lanes marching up a steep wooded hillside. It was one part pastoral tropics, one part humming city. I was instantly smitten. We landed and taxied to the gate, and I turned on my cell phone to review my instructions from Verizon. All calls would incur international roaming charges, they said, but text messages, emails, and internet use were all considered domestic. If I was talking, I was abroad. If I was typing, I was still in the United States. A neat, physics-defying party trick. I texted my wife, Marin, to confirm my safe arrival, then read the headlines on the New York Times website, which automatically redirected me to the International Edition. When I clicked over to a local news site, the top stories were about dengue fever fears, the results of a regatta, and an area skier who was making final preparations for the Winter Olympics, where she would represent her tiny but proud national team. I disembarked and instinctively looked for the sign to customs, but there was no customs. Not on the way in, though there would be on the way out. Paperwork, passport check, the whole gauntlet. The owner of the guest house where I was staying met me at baggage claim, a burly guy named Ronnie Lockhart. He was grizzled and outwardly gruff, but with a low-key kindness. Think of your stereotype of a retired cop. As we headed into town, I noted that traffic drove on the left, like the British, but the cars were American, with steering wheels on the left. This was a combination I didn't know existed anywhere in the world, and it was a perpetual struggle not to yell out to Ronnie that he was driving on the wrong side of the road. We wound past branches of Banco Popular and Scotia Bank, past a U.S. National Guard recruiting storefront. The buildings were low-slung, with red-tile-hipped roofs and large louvered windows, and every surface fading and peeling in that inevitable tropical way. The streets were called Moravian Highway, and Kronprinzengal, and Espagnol, and Rue de Saint-Barthélemy, and Main Street. American flags twisted in the breeze outside all the official-looking buildings, but there were also quite a few Danish flags in places of prominence, and flashes of the green-gold-red stripes of Ethiopia on retaining wall murals and cafe awnings. Outside the local cricket grounds, a billboard for a cell phone company showed a player in all-white regalia with the tagline, "No drifters, no yips, no ducks. Basically, straight up." A couple of blocks later, a well-kept baseball stadium advertised upcoming appearances by major league stars. Everywhere, there were signals that I was in my homeland. Everywhere, there were signals that I was not. The sign at the airport had read, "Welcome to St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands." I was still in the USA, but far from the States. From 13 original colonies, as every school kid knows, the USA has become a nation of 50 proud states. So pleasingly, conclusively round, that number. So tidily, those rows of stars fit on the flag, as though geopolitical destiny were dictated by graphic design convenience. But despite what we advertise on our flag, despite what it says right there in our name, the United States of America is not merely a nation of states, but also, legally and officially, of those scattered shards of earth and populace that make up our outposts far from the North American continent. The territories of the Virgin Islands of the United States, American Samoa, Guam, the Northern Mariana Islands, and Puerto Rico, along with the uninhabited minor outlying islands. They have U.S. national parks and American Legion posts and U.S. post offices. Just a standard first-class stamp gets your mail there. It's all the same country. Their millions of citizens earn American dollars and pay into Social Security and Medicare and serve in the U.S. military at impressively high rates. They participate in the Scripps-Howard National Spelling Bee and receive Pell Grants and play Little League Baseball and have 4-H clubs and serve as United States ambassadors. They pledge allegiance to the American flag, even if Old Glory hasn't made room for them. Yet for the average resident of the states, lowercase s, because states with a capital S would be the whole nation, the territories are all but forgotten. They're extant but inconsequential, vestiges from another era whose ongoing existence is a cultural curiosity, like tab soda or professional mini golf. They flicker into our consciousness here and there, an offbeat news story, a friend's tropical island vacation photos, a passing reference in the fine print of a governmental form. And for a moment we think, oh right, we have territories. Then, just as quickly, they disappear from our minds once more. Nobody knows in America. Puerto Rico's in America, goes a line in West Side Story, the musical that may be the primary entry point for many Americans' knowledge of the territories. But in the classic patriotic songbook, they get no mention. America the Beautiful stretches from sea to shining sea, not across the seas, just as they're absent from the maps in television weather forecasts and magazine infographics and classroom walls, even though Alaska and Hawaii typically sneak in with their not-to-scale boxes. The territories are not part of our conception of ourselves. Picture the archetypal American across the eras, indigenous peoples and bewigged founding fathers and wilderness homesteaders and slaves and miners and cowboys and World War winning soldiers and factory workers and opportunity seeking immigrants and outer ring suburb dwellers. And you are almost certainly imagining their natural habitat to be, implicitly, the states. Search the classic tales of the American road trip, that keystone of the country's literary canon, and you'll find, among others, Alexis de Tocqueville on the trail of Democracy in America, from Boston to Green Bay, which was then part of the Northwest Territory, to the Gulf of Mexico. Mark Twain traipsing across the West and to the then Kingdom of Hawaii in Roughing It, and Sal Paradise and Dean Moriarty bopping from coast to coast and into Mexico in Jack Kerouac's On the Road. But none of the most famous journeys in search of America, as they are inevitably framed, have included the present-day territories, the not-quite states. For that matter, no sitting American president has visited all 5 inhabited territories. Lyndon B. Johnson holds the lead with 3. He was also the last president to visit American Samoa in 1967. No sitting president has ever been to the Northern Mariana Islands. Until very recently, I couldn't even list the territories, let alone tell you anything about them. And if there's anyone with no excuse for this, it's me, a travel writer with a college degree in American Studies. My obsession with Americana runs deep, pulsing through my childhood in Minneapolis when my parents read me Travels with Charlie and How Many Miles to Galena at bedtime, two more American road trip books with no love for the territories. For my fifth birthday, I asked Mom and Dad to take me to Mickey's Diner, a St. Paul institution of neon and chrome and short-order cooks. I'd never been before, but thought it looked like my kind of place. I ate French toast, and a crusty biker gave me a dollar. It's one of my earliest memories, and a scene I've long thought embodies the United States at its egalitarian finest. The wide-eyed preschooler and the burly Harley rider bonding over greasy food. Years later, at Carleton College, amid the prairies and cornfields of southern Minnesota, I channeled this fascination into actual academics. I could rattle off esoteric facts about the states and hold forth for hours on history and culture of the states and tell you the name of just about every capital of the states. I graduated with the self-satisfied confidence of the newly diplomaed. I am a credentialed expert on all things American. When I started out as a writer, my gaze turned overseas. I filed stories from Rome, from Ecuador, from a tiny Icelandic island. I was ever on the lookout for Americana and how it translated abroad. I can recommend the diner in Paris, but must warn you away from Tex-Mex in Berlin, but also prided myself as someone with a certain worldliness, a better-than-average understanding of how the European Union functioned, the politics of Costa Rica, the rising role of Chinese industry on the African continent. Yet in all this time, it never occurred to me, Mr. American Studies guy, Mr. Globally Aware Travel Writer, that there was more of my very own country to consider. Parts of the USA about which I was not just fairly ignorant, but almost wholly unaware. Places I could not reliably find on a map within 1,000 miles, or even, in some cases, within the correct hemisphere. And then, one day, I encountered what I now think of as the Quarters of Destiny. Zoom in on a 3-story, slightly shabby brick apartment building in South Minneapolis on a blustery Saturday morning in November. In a basement unit, Marin and I stand by our kitchen table with a glass jar full of pocket change. It's laundry day, and our attire shows it. She in yoga pants, I in tattered soccer shorts. Her shoulder-grazing chestnut hair is pulled back in a ponytail, and her blue-green eyes are alight as we prepare to crank through our to-do list, beginning with sorting out the quarters from the jar. Most were destined for the washers and dryers down the hall, but if we were lucky, we'd find one or two state quarters to add to Marin's collection, which by now filled most of a cardboard portfolio with a cover awash in a collage featuring George Washington and the Statue of Liberty. On this day, we found one, Montana, from the Philadelphia Mint, and after Marin placed it in the proper spot, we took a moment to admire the rest of the nearly complete lineup of silvery discs, arranged in chronological order of admission from Delaware, 1787, to Hawaii, 1959. Past Hawaii, I noticed, there were more quarters. I'm sure I'd seen them before, but they never registered. I pointed them out to Marin. "Yeah," she grinned, "the territories." "All right," I said. "We have territories. I plucked the coins from the portfolio. The designs bore mottos in wholly unfamiliar languages and objects that I couldn't identify. Briefly interesting, but we had laundry to do, so I put the quarters back and promptly forgot about them. A few days later, Marin saw a news article about a vast tropical paradise of a U.S. national park, all primeval jungles and comely beaches and sapphire waters. The photos conjured escapist daydreams as the winds of early-onset winter bent the trees outside our window. It was the second least visited of all national parks. Even fewer people visit a park in remote Alaska, which is much less appealing to a Minnesotan in November, and it was called the National Park of American Samoa. Oh yeah, I thought, American Samoa. That's one of those mysterious places on the quarters. I want to go there, Marin said, adding, what's the deal with the territories anyway? I laughed, but then realized I couldn't answer the question. I had no idea why or how the United States controlled them, why they weren't states, who lived there, what life was like there. I couldn't name the first thing about local cultural traditions, attire, public transportation, what the billboards advertised, what the air smelled like. None of that. And it suddenly bugged me that I didn't know. This was supposed to be my area of expertise. I looked at the quarters again and read the vital stats listed on a small flap in the portfolio. Here was the primer I'd never gotten in college. Puerto Rico. Status designation, Commonwealth. Year it officially became part of the United States, 1898. Capital, San Juan. Population, about 3.5 million. Quarter at first glance, a lovely view of the turret of a stone fort overlooking the sea, with a tropical-looking flower hovering off to the side and the words Isla del Encanto embossed in the sky. Guam. Status designation, organized, unincorporated territory. Year it officially became part of the United States, 1898. Capital, Hagatnya. Population, about 165,000. Quarter at first glance, an outline of the island with a spray of bumps representing what I assumed were mountains, plus an outrigger sailboat and mushroom-looking thing that might have been a drum. Inscription on the coin, Guahan Itano Manchimara. U.S. Virgin Islands. Status designation, organized unincorporated territory. Year it officially became part of the United States, 1917. Capital, Charlotte Amalia. Population, about 105,000. Quarter, at first glance, three small islands, a cluster of shaggy-headed palm trees, and a smallish bird perched on a branch, blooming with largish flowers that are surely colorful and enchantingly tropical in real life. Motto, United in Pride and Hope. American Samoa. Status designation, unorganized, unincorporated territory. Year it officially became part of the United States, 1900. Capital, Pago Pago. Population, about 55,000. Quarter, at first glance, a beach with palm trees and, maybe an aerial view of the Roman Colosseum? Or a traditional bowl of some kind? Also, something that looked a bit like a broom and some kind of traditional staff-type thing. Above the bowl, there was text reading, Samoa Mua Mua Leatua. Northern Mariana Islands. Status designation, Commonwealth. Year it officially became part of the United States, 1976. Capital, Saipan. Population, about 54,000. Quarter, at first glance, a seaside tableau featuring a beach, another of those mushroom drum things like on Guam's quarter, another outrigger sailboat, three small palm trees, two soaring birds, and a lei-like garland forming a half-wreath along the bottom. No words. I started to do a bit more research and learned that in addition to the quarter-worthy territories, there are 11 puny bits of earth, islands, atolls, banks, rocky outcroppings, that are part of the United States' insular areas, which is to say the places that aren't states or federal districts, like the District of Columbia, but still fall under American sovereignty, though some are also claimed by other nations. These far-flung specks of unpeopled land are grouped together as the minor outlying islands. There are three in the Caribbean: Navassa Island, Serenia Bank, and Bajo Nuevo Bank, and eight in the Pacific: Baker Island, Howland Island, Jarvis Island, Johnston Atoll, Kingman Reef, Midway Atoll, Wake Island, and Palmyra Atoll. All have an official population of zero, although some have non-permanent populations at military installations or scientific research stations. If your head is already spinning a bit, well, so was mine. My mental picture of those quarter-enshrined places was a hybrid of my own broad-brush stereotypes of both American culture and tropical locales. Marching bands on surfboards, roadside diners whose blue plate specials were served in hollowed-out pineapples, baseball fields in rainforest clearings, highways lined with palm trees and strip malls of the Swiss Family Robinson School of Design, with monkeys drolly swinging from the ceiling at Foot Locker, and dolphins frolicking in the food court fountain, and mall cops wearing leis. Norman Rockwell in a bikini. Obviously, that wasn't right. Obviously, I had no clue. I trekked to the bookstore in search of a history of the territories, or anything related to the subject, and found nothing at all. I searched Amazon, and the first page of results for U.S. territories was filled with coin-collecting portfolios like Marin's, plus sheets of stickers. I went to the Minneapolis Central Library, the main repository of information in a city routinely ranked among the nation's most well-read places, and found only obscure congressional bills. Nothing about the territories collectively, and the handful of books on the individual territories were difficult to track down because they were split up in different parts of the library, categorized not with United States history, but with their surrounding region of the world. The U.S. Virgin Islands, for example, were grouped with the rest of the Caribbean, though, aside from travel guides, there were only two books about the territory. On the same shelf, there were more volumes about the infamous Captain Morgan. But once I started finding information, the intrigue made it worth the wait. One day I typed Guam into Google. That's all, Guam. I had intended to get a quick overview of its history, but I got distracted by the present in the form of the Google News headlines, of which there were three. Guam, luring Russian tourist dollars thanks to visa waiver, from the Moscow Times. U.S. plans for Guam missile base seen as countering strength of China, from the South China Morning Post. Dead mice update. Tiny assassins dropped on Guam again, from National Public Radio. The dead mice had been stuffed full of acetaminophen, Tylenol, and dropped from helicopters into the jungle as poison to control the brown tree snake population. Again. Evidently, it had worked previously. How many snakes were there? So here you had an island that was at once overflowing with tourists from around the world, infested with jungle snakes with a taste for over-the-counter painkillers, and also served as the front line for keeping the world's rising superpower in check. And that was just the news from a random Tuesday. Clearly, this was a place worth getting to know more. The history, along with that of the other territories, turned out to be even more fascinating, with mixed-up histories of conquest and corrupt governors who sounded like Victorian-era literature villains come to life, all pith helmets and extravagant mustaches and diabolical plots. In various territories, there were pirates and bloody fights for independence and hippie dropouts and eccentric millionaires who lived in castles. It also seemed that, right around the turn of the 20th century, the territories were part of the national mythology and the everyday conversation. "I have recently been traveling over a large part of the United States," wrote Benjamin Kidd in The Atlantic in December 1898. "On this subject of overseas expansion, I talked with the people generally. It was impossible to avoid." It was one of the focal points of the 1900 presidential election between Republican William McKinley and Democrat William Jennings Bryan. A century or so ago, Americans didn't just know about the territories, but cared about them, argued about them. But what changed? How and why did they disappear from the national conversation? Was there a compelling reason why they mattered for the present-day USA, or were they just remnants of a long-past historical moment? As I kept reading, I became more baffled and obsessed. And more than once, I also thought, well, that's messed up. For instance, there was the fact that residents of the territories cannot vote for president because they're shut out of the Electoral College. Americans who live in any other nation on Earth can vote absentee back in the States. Even American astronauts in the International Space Station can vote for president. But Americans whose official address is in the territories, American soil, cannot. A fact that would seem to be at odds with the very ideals of our democracy. They can, however, run for president. John McCain was born in the Panama Canal Zone back when it was part of the USA. In other words, in the 2008 election, there was a candidate who was not born in the States. But, contrary to the swirling conspiracy theories, it wasn't Barack Obama. They can also vote in the presidential primaries and be delegates at the political party's national conventions. The governor of Puerto Rico spoke at the Republican National Convention in 2012, followed a few minutes later by a family band from American Samoa. There was also a major asterisk when it came to congressional representation. Like the states, territories elect representatives to serve them in Washington, D.C. They have offices on the Hill, participate in committee discussions, do many of the things other congresspeople do, except that they can't vote on any bills, which is to say they can't do the most important thing that congresspeople do. Washington, D.C. gets 3 electoral votes, but has a similar congressional setup. There was layer upon topsy-turvy layer of weirdness in the history, in the politics, in the present-day life. I'm a sucker for far-flung quirk, and here, it seemed, I'd hit the jackpot. It's a big, wonderful, crazy place, this country of ours, and I love it. I love it precisely because it's such a diverse, enigmatic, ever-evolving patchwork, one you could spend a lifetime trying to understand. And the only way to do that, really, is to get out there and see it. On his deathbed in 1936, King George V of Great Britain asked, "How is the empire?" His domain, of course, spanned truly across the globe. India, Hong Kong, Gibraltar, Bermuda, the list goes on. The sun never set. Our modern American outposts are not nearly as numerous or as populated as our one-time rulers were in their heyday, but it's still curious that our holdings have no cohesive, collective reputation. If any of our leaders asked, "How is the empire?" the most likely public response would be, "We don't have an empire." Yet today, with a population of nearly 4 million people, the U.S. territories are more than 10 times larger than the present-day colonial outposts of the British Empire. They're larger, in fact, than the remaining colonies of all the old-fashioned imperial dominions. Britain, Spain, France, Denmark, Belgium, the Netherlands, and so on, combined. I wanted to answer King George's question for my own nation. I wanted to meet the people, eat the food, sniff the air, experience everyday life in all its joy and tragedy and poetry and banality. So I packed my bag with sunscreen and, as a talisman, a red, white, and blue checkered shirt. And I set off on a journey that would lead me from traditional villages to modern metropolises to lost world jungles more than 31,000 miles, crossing the equator and the international dateline, but never changing currency or getting a visa. An altogether different sort of all-American road trip. A very brief note on the territories and their various designations. Before hitting the road, let's establish some of the key terms used to categorize the territories. 1. All territories are either organized or unorganized, which has to do with whether or not they've passed an organic act, which is essentially a territorial constitution. 2. The territories are also either incorporated or unincorporated, which describes whether or not a place is considered fully part of, incorporated with, the United States and all of its federal laws. Unincorporated means that some, but not all, of the U.S. Constitution applies, that Congress has ultimate oversight and veto power over everything, and that the place is neither on equal terms with the states nor officially on the path to statehood. All inhabited territories are unincorporated. Guam and the U.S. Virgin Islands are organized unincorporated territories. Puerto Rico and the Northern Mariana Islands are officially commonwealths, not territories at all. Theoretically, commonwealths have a bit more local autonomy, though there's much debate about the real-world distinction between the two designations. For all practical purposes, commonwealths are just another form of organized unincorporated territories. And so, for the most part, I'm using territories as a catch-all term, including the commonwealths. American Samoa and most minor outlying islands are unorganized, unincorporated territories. Then there's Palmyra Atoll, which is 1,000 miles south of Hawaii and is unorganized but incorporated. From a legal standpoint, this 5-square-mile atoll with no permanent population has more constitutional rights than any inhabited territory. If that seems a bit unexpected, well, we're just getting started. Chapter 1. The Empire's New Clothes. The Virgin Islands of the United States. By the time I got to the rum bar in the rainforest, the beer-drinking pigs were already sloshed. The bartender had cut them off. I was crushed, deprived of that obscure but potent strain of the American dream. If you work hard, someday you will be able to buy cans of beer at a jungle bar and give them to pigs in a pen out back. They will grasp the cans in their capacious mouths, bite them open, chug the contents, and spit out the crushed aluminum with rapturous grins, while you think, "This is a magnificent country." The bar, a palm-roofed, open-sided hut called the Montpellier Domino Club, was up a lonely, hilly road, tunneled by trees and cratered with potholes. It was about 4 miles inland from the town of Frederickstead, on the west side of St. Croix, the largest of the four U.S. Virgin Islands. The pigs were large, state fair-sized, and had a loutish charm as they lunged for the cans, front legs up on the edge of their pens, keening. Their thirst is so prodigious that some years ago they switched over to non-alcoholic beer on doctor's orders, after too many piglets were born with fetal alcohol syndrome. Yet the corpulent porkers sometimes overdo it even on O'Doul's, all that cheered-on chugging, tiring them out. Like today, when a cruise ship was in port in Frederickstead, and the tourist vans kept coming and coming. "They're done. We've had enough excitement for the day," the bar's owner Norma, a stout Trinidadian of middle years, told me when I arrived around 4 p.m. I settled onto a stool at the bar, a small three-sided affair with a worn wood countertop, and dried palm fronds beckoned lazily from the ceiling. On the far wall behind the bar, a shelf held more types of rum than I knew existed, most of them Cruzan, the island's pride. There was seating for perhaps 15 around the bar, but right now there were just 3 other patrons, who had all moved down from the mainland, USA, decades ago. There was Leon, wearing a coral polo shirt and rimless glasses, and who I took to be a retired business executive. Ray, whose calculator watch and unkempt hair telegraphed science teacher. And Linda, a woman I couldn't quite read, aside from noting her intense gaze and the incongruity of the chartreuse bike helmet she was wearing while sitting at the bar. They were clearly regulars, their conversation suffused with a jocular familiarity that can only be earned through many hours and many drinks together. Leon. "I should leave soon to get to Home Depot and repot my orchids before it gets dark." Ray. "When's your orchid show in Florida?" Leon. "Next month. You should tag along. There'll be plenty of ladies there." The topics caromed unhurriedly. The state of local property values, the surprisingly high quality of the bar's Johnny Cakes, a fried flatbread, dense and delicious, and the need, oft stated but never acted upon, to head home for the day. The 3 bartenders chimed in as conversational equals. There were 2 young women and Norma, who held court with an easygoing charisma from a folding chair in the center of the bar area. All in all, it was the sort of take-a-load-off-you're-with-friends atmosphere you'd find at any corner dive bar in the States. As if to prove the workaday nature of the place, and defying all jungle rum bar logic, Ray and Linda were drinking cans of Old Milwaukee in foam cozies, which they'd brought from home. Of course, I thought. That makes sense. And the thing is, I meant it. Everything about this place had a certain offbeat logic, in keeping with the rhythms of life here. I'd been in the U.S. Virgin Islands for more than a week now, and had come to expect these sorts of pairings, to smile and nod and appreciate the multiverse of possibilities. When I first arrived in Charlotte Amalia, St. Thomas, the territory's capital and commercial center, with 18,500 residents, my disorientation was so profound that I could feel my gray matter pulsing. All those mixed messages, from my phone, to the street names, to the American cars driving British style on the left. I took it all in, wide-eyed, enchanted. I was staying at a guest house called the Crystal Palace, a cardinal red Spanish colonial manor midway up one of Charlotte Amalia's three hills. It was the longtime family home of the proprietor, Ronnie Lockhart, a fifth-generation St. Tomian. His grandfather, he said, had designed the territorial flag. The house had a distinct feel of fading grandeur, particularly the third-floor living room, with its oil paintings of sailing ships and a rack of Panama hats that looked like they hadn't been touched for decades. The living room was open to a tiled porch, where I lingered the first morning, eating a bowl of frosted flakes. The town and the harbor laid out before me. The waterfront was just three blocks away and seemed so close that I could reach out and touch it, nudge the crowds of tourists walking along its edge, pick up the massive yachts at anchor, including the white and gleaming and wedge-like I-Ship, designed by and for Steve Jobs. The low-angled sunlight pumped up the already saturated colors. The red tile rooftops, the lush green hills, the azure acreage of placid sea. I texted photos to Marin as fast as I could take them, while Ronnie watched, entertained by my awe. At the mouth of the harbor bulged smallish Hassel Island and the larger 2-square-mile Water Island, population 182. The latter is the runt of the 4 official U.S. Virgin Islands, which also include St. Thomas, population 51,000, and the governmental and commercial center, St. John, 3 miles east, with about 4,000 people, and the national park of the Virgin Islands. And St. Croix, 40 miles south, home to roughly 50,000 residents, and twice the land area of St. Thomas. Along with the British Virgin Islands, just a few miles north and east of St. John, these are the northwestern points of the Lesser Antilles, the chain of hilly, ink-blot landmasses curving along the eastern edge of the Caribbean. Between the Crystal Palace and the harbor was a grid of narrow lanes and low-slung historic buildings outlined in white trim. To either side, more of the same, and on some of the more vertiginous inclines, steps replaced streets on the most direct route up the hill. The city beckoned. "Come on down, Doug. You can wander for hours, meander for days, explore for..." "You won't be going anywhere except where I tell you," Ronnie said. "Go another way, and they're probably gonna take your wallet and maybe shoot you." He pointed out the one acceptable route for the short walk to the harbor as he leaned over the edge of the porch, his gaze narrowing. I sighed heavily, recalling the crime warnings I'd read before my trip. I'd tried hard not to get too anxious about them, particularly since, inevitably, one of the key anecdotes, dated to before I was born, the 1972 mass shooting at the Fountain Valley Golf Course on St. Croix, which targeted tourists and left 8 people dead. Even now, I knew, the USVI had one of the highest murder rates on the planet. But I'd been clinging to tourist denial, in the thrall of the tropical landscape and centuries-old streetscape. "Last year they killed somebody during night out against crime in Frenchtown," Ronnie said, meeting my alarmed gaze. Satisfied that I understood his point, he looked back down at the town. "And that is a real problem," he growled. I looked down, expecting to see some menacing figure, but he was gesturing to the rooftops of Main Street, a block inland from the waterfront and lined with duty-free shops in historic buildings. Above the red tile danced a green inflatable arm waver, that kitschy icon of car sales lots. "They wouldn't have that at Colonial Williamsburg, and they shouldn't have it here," Ronnie said. He stared hard at the arm waver, clearly hoping today would be the day he mastered telekinesis. Two other guests ambled onto the porch, a middle-aged couple from Denmark, and then a third, also Danish. This was a funny coincidence, I said out loud, which was met with a quartet of blank stares. We get a lot of Danes here, Ronnie said, in the same tone that someone at Disney World might say, we get a lot of families. Before 1917, these islands were known as the Danish West Indies. This much I knew from my research. I hadn't understood, though, that modern-day Danes come here by the planeful, including regular charter flights from Copenhagen to Charlotte Amalia, as one of my breakfast companions, Anne, now explained. They spread out across the islands to see the sights that are part of their history, but no longer part of their homeland. The forts and edifices preserved and docent staffed by a country with no claim to this specific history. Anne turned out to be the president of the Danish West Indies Historical Society. She was studious and chic in blue-framed glasses. The topic turned to history, and I showed her the books I had in the messenger bag at my feet. I pulled them out, and, one by one, she dismissed each as inferior, with a small, shy wince. Then she talked me into buying her own book for $55. Ronnie stood idly at the edge of the porch, chuckling at my conversation with Anne and glaring at the arm waver. Finally, he looked up with a smirk and said, "She respects history." From a narrowly focused American perspective, the most important event in the history of the Danish West Indies may have been the arrival on St. Croix in 1765 of a pale, red-headed boy of 8 or 10 years old, the record is inconclusive, named Alexander, and his subsequent coming of age in Christiansted, the island's largest town. His was an inauspicious beginning. Born out of wedlock on the Caribbean island of Nevis to a Scottish immigrant mother who died 3 years after they arrived on St. Croix, leaving her two sons orphaned. But young Alexander was a sharp-witted autodidact, and in 1772 he wrote a newspaper essay that so impressed local leaders that they raised funds to send him to college in the British colonies in North America. He continued to thrive, and soon he was a household name, Alexander Hamilton. It's amusing to imagine him, or any other founding father, wandering the present-day streets of the U.S. Virgin Islands, or, if you're a local, the USVI, or most frequently just the VI. The Danish colonial architecture would feel familiar enough, and I do enjoy picturing Benjamin Franklin's reaction to the I-ship. But I suspect they'd all be taken aback by the fact that these islands are now part of the United States, but not actual states, and not on any path to statehood. A setup that, politically, would surely strike them as very much like a colony. A loaded word, one intentionally erased from the aspiring nation's name. As Bill Bryson notes in Made in America, at the time of the Revolution, even the boldest patriot referred to the United Colonies rather than the United States, until Thomas Paine coined the latter term, and here we are. Hamilton and company debated national expansion fervently as they planned for their new nation. Hamilton, for his part, didn't think a free republic could or should be maintained in a large geographical area, but did hope that the United States would push westward to the strategic port of New Orleans. This, he told George Washington, may be regarded as essential to the unity of the empire. Thomas Jefferson opposed expansion, using the slippery slope argument to suggest that, if this became the trend, the United States might receive England, Holland, Ireland, etc. into it. The new nation's leaders drafted a colonial policy, the Northwest Ordinance, in 1787, a year before they ratified the Constitution. The ordinance was originally intended to address the Northwest Territory, what we now know as Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, Illinois, Wisconsin, and Minnesota, but came to serve as the precedent for further national expansion. New acquisitions would go through a three-stage process to become states. Step 1, Congress appoints a governor, a secretary, and three-judge court. Step 2, once a territory has 5,000 free male inhabitants of full age, it sets up a local legislature. Step 3, the territory writes up a local constitution and, congratulations, you're now a state. Alternatively, if a territory reaches 60,000 free inhabitants, slaves, alas, don't count, it can be admitted before drafting a constitution. 33 of today's 50 states were previously territories. The Constitution, too, considered the territories, although only briefly and in terms that, like everything else in that august document, are open to perpetual interpretation and argument. There are two relevant parts, both in Article 4, Section 3. The first says, "New states may be admitted by the Congress into this Union." The second, known as the Territorial Clause, decrees that "Congress shall have the power to dispose of and make all needful rules and regulations respecting the territory and other property belonging to the United States." In other words, and this is still true today, Congress has ultimate and full authority over the territories. States' rights, that fiercely protected hallmark of our democracy, far surpass territories' rights. Where, precisely, congressional authority begins and ends is a question that has kept the courts busy ever since. The nation pushed ever westward, often, of course, at the expense of American Indians and other claimants to land, about whom much has been written elsewhere, and more than doubled with the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. The sale was authorized by none other than longtime expansion skeptic Thomas Jefferson, with encouragement from Alexander Hamilton in defiance of his Federalist Party compatriots. Hamilton rival Aaron Burr, for his part, hoped the Louisiana Territory would secede from the Union and that he would be its leader. Guided by the Northwest Ordinance, the new territories followed a gradual but straightforward process to statehood. Louisiana in 1812, Mississippi in 1817, Arkansas in 1836. This was how the nation grew, at each step gaining more confidence and ambition and feeling more emboldened to challenge the more established global powers. European nations had long dominated the Americas. France, Great Britain, Denmark, the Netherlands, Portugal, and most of all, Spain. But Spain's holdings dwindled as independence movements swept through Mexico, Colombia, Venezuela, Argentina, Peru, and Chile in the 1810s and 1820s. The United States sensed an opportunity to assert its own power in the region, and in 1823, President James Monroe issued a command to Europe, "Back off!" The Monroe Doctrine was a geopolitical restraining order of sorts. "We'll stay out of your continental affairs, and you'd better not mess around in our hemisphere, claiming new colonies or stirring things up." Expansion was a constant presidential campaign issue. James Polk was elected in 1844 after promising to annex Texas, which he did, antagonizing Mexico. The ensuing war netted the United States much of what we now know as the Southwest, plus all of California. To the north, Polk worked out the Oregon Treaty of 1846, adding what's now the Pacific Northwest. What's often lost in the Go West, young man mythology of the nation is the fact that California and Oregon were not only desirable on their own terms, but as stepping stones for controlling the Pacific, just as Britain had long dominated the Atlantic. San Francisco was a superlative port. The rest of California was a nice bonus. In 1846, then-Senator William Seward decreed that "Our population is destined to roll its resistless waves to the icy barriers of the North and to encounter Oriental civilization on the shores of the Pacific." Expansion was never simply about having more people in more places, as Polk and Hamilton and Jefferson all understood. It was about claiming areas of strategic utility. It was about enhancing the nation's power in the world. Or, in some cases, it was about domestic strategy. In 1854, President Franklin Pierce, who had already given serious thought to acquiring Alaska, Hawaii, and Nicaragua, worked up plans for purchasing Cuba, or wresting it from Spain, for the purpose of adding another slave-owning state to the South. At the root of this drive was a belief that, in the instantly famous words of the United States Magazine and Democratic Review in 1845, it was "our manifest destiny to overspread the continent allotted by Providence for the free development of our yearly multiplying millions." Expansion was a mission from God. With the view and the Danes to keep me company, I was tempted to sit on Ronnie's porch all day, but I'd come here to see America. Precisely what I wanted to see and how I planned to see it, I wasn't quite sure. Enter Monica, with a loose white blouse, bronze skin, and her jet-black hair pulled into a tight bun. She was born and raised in St. Thomas, lived there until she was about 30, then fell in love with a Dane and moved to Denmark. She was going to take the three Danes on a tour of her old stomping grounds. Would I like to join them? I nodded eagerly. The Danes looked disappointed. 10 minutes later, the five of us were wedged into Monica's gray sedan and headed up a narrow, meandering roller coaster road that veered through the jungle and across the island's plump hills, which top out at more than 1,000 feet. As we slowed for one tight switchback, Monica said, "I used to come up here when I was learning to drive, and my boyfriend was trying to quit smoking. This curve tested us both." When the trees thinned for a moment, we could see squiggly coastlines and small valleys where a million shades of green were offset by scattered bursts of floral blooms, nature's fireworks in gold and pink and fire truck red. Humble but well-kept cinder-block houses perched on the inclines, some with flat roofs outlined with rebar reaching for the sky, an aspirational halo of hope for a second or third story sometime soon. The trees tapered off, and the road straightened out. We turned down a dirt road with a colorful hand-painted sign reading, "Bordeaux Farmers Marketplace." A wide path lined with wooden market stalls curved around a corner toward a pavilion the size of a small airplane hangar. The air was thick and humid after a brief sunshower, and the whirr of a weed whacker signaled that just out of sight someone was hard at work. We followed Monica to the pavilion, where several men were chatting. Monica greeted them all warmly.
"Good morning! Good morning!"
to the preppy white guy who was dropping off some solar panels.
"Good morning, good morning,"
to the black Rasta in dreadlocks, including his beard, and tall white rubber boots. It's standard practice in the USVI to greet everyone you see, friend or stranger, in restaurants, on buses, walking down the street. As one man would tell me, "You can call someone a mother, say anything you want, but the worst insult is not saying good morning or good afternoon. How you doing?" The marketplace stalls were painted with green, gold, and red stripes and symbols familiar to anyone who has wandered into the Bob Marley section of a poster shop. regal lions, black stars, slogans like, "Hail the King, Rastafari Live!" This, I realized, was what I'd seen on the retaining wall murals the night before. Rastafari iconography, the real deal kind. The pavilion overlooked terraced hillsides, and Monica led us down a muddy path, exchanging pleasantries and gossip with everyone she passed. I got into the spirit, offering my own chipper greetings. The Danes gave me sideways glances. On one of the terraces, a tall, burly man was clearing the field with a weed whacker. He looked up and switched it off as Monica approached, giving her a familiar wave. His name was Eldridge Thomas, and he seemed to be in charge here. "We started as an agricultural group and evolved into a Rasta group," he said. They were preparing for their annual 2-day festival, where farmers sold their goods. Everything vegan and wholesome, a sort of Whole Foods of the islands, followed by concerts in the evenings. The festival was a showcase of the specialty produce they grew on the farm, including some things I'd never heard of. Egg fruit, breadfruit, and guava berry, which Eldridge said was not the same as a guava. He pointed out a type of mango called Guinness and multiple varieties of avocados, pears in the local parlance. In my mind, I was slicing them open and taking messy bites. A sunshower began spritzing us, but I was in no hurry to take shelter and end the conversation. Perhaps he'd offer us a sample if we stayed just a bit longer. I could see the Danes eyeing the pavilion. "What kind of music do you play at the concerts?" I asked Eldridge. "Reggae, of course," he said, and I caught the Danes snickering as I blushed. I decided to change the subject. "Do you have many young people out here working the land?" "Well," Eldridge began. His shoulders slumped a bit as he answered. "No." They didn't have much interest from the younger generation. "It's hard work, the kind that doesn't always pay off, even when you put in your best effort," he said. He pointed to an avocado tree that had been stubbornly refusing to yield fruit for more than 20 years. "She had all that time to prove herself," he said. "But we'll give her one more summer. We'll give her that." "Local agriculture is in danger," he continued, lamenting Virgin Islanders' over-reliance on imported goods and a general lack of support from the local and federal government. "The politicians just give money to people who already have it. They don't care about agriculture," he said, adding that it was only 1% of the USVI's overall budget. "Tourism gets all the attention, all the funding, all those ships in Charlotte Amalia, all those beachfront resorts. But I keep telling them..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.